Now we come to my notes here, my typewritten notes. It is integral to the book and to the story in whatever form it's presented that Mary Poppins should never be impolite to anybody. We get the comedy out of this grave, quiet, polite person through which all the strange magic happens. He asks her a few things, you see, because you say later on he thought at the beginning there was something wrong with her. And it would be very good if he said, and what was your last position? Seems to have seen her, but he doesn't say so. He answers a family of repute, sir. And where before that would a family have even greater repute, sir?
They all continue across the street toward the park where they meet Bert, the pavement artist.
Mary! Good morning, Bert. Very pleasant to see you, you see. Keeping her nanniness the whole time, you see. Bert can be a little uproarious, but she must stay inside her shape.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. He's a matchman, you see. He's got matchboxes and so on, as well as drawing the pictures. He jumps up from the pictures. Perhaps this is the first time they've seen the matchman making pictures. You see, something like that. Did you draw these? And Bert says, all my own work drawn from memory.
I like your pictures very much. They are really quite lifelike. The pictures react indignantly. And why shouldn't we be lifelike? Asks the field marshal. Indeed, says his lady.
Not lifelike, but truly. Bert laughs at her and he says, oh, Mary Poppins, mm-hmm. Something always happens with your life. I see you've got Bert suggests that they spend the afternoon in his park. He can look at the picture of the countryside, all trees and grass and so on. And after he said, Mary, you always do something wonderful, he looks at the kids with a sort of, well, a quizzical look. How'd you like to go in there? Hey, Jane, in there, into a picture. Mary Poppins says, follow me.
Orton diminish in size, and they jump into the picture. We then cut to in the countryside, where all the costumes and the backgrounds seem to be created of pastels and chalk drawings.
Just like Bert's picture.
Just like
but Bert. How is that arranged?
What did he have magic?
All right, I'll leave that. Yes, we'll go along.
The music is Jolly Holiday again.
For it's a jolly holiday.
That's right.
Mary. Of course, by that time they're seated in this little outside pavilion, and Mary and they're being seated, and the waiters so they say good morning, Miss Poppins, and then Mary starts to order, but she's doing it in the song, and she says, now then, won't it be nice? We'll start with raspberry ice, and then some cake and tea, and then the waiters, of course, chime in kind of barbershop harmony.
Mm-hmm.
Then they sing, order what you will, there'll be no bill, complimentary. And then they have the creations to this wonderful thing that's going on.
Yes.
And it's quite a funny act they're doing.
Yes.
They're pouring tea from funny angles, and they're very dignified about the whole thing.
There ought perhaps to have been people walking around while, you know, there are people in this countryside, you see, and they would be the pearly people. And as they sit down and Mary orders strawberry ice and waiters all do this, the pearlies come in to watch, you see.
And couldn't Michael explain, oh, that was... It, you know, he's referring to, it's a jolly holiday,
yes.
And then he can't find the word.
What's better than wonderful, Mary Poppins?
And then she says, why, anyone knows it's supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. And actually, perhaps they want to do better than the waiters, so that's the reason why they want to do their song, because they feel they can entertain as well as any four waiters can entertain.
In other words, this goes, so when you're at the ball, the words, there's no need for the snake.
And then they wave goodbye and they keep singing, hum diddle diddle diddle, hum diddle lay, hum diddle, and they sort of fade out. And they say, bye now, you know, and it was a lot of fun, and they leave. And we hear in the distance a calliope which sounds.
They circle around our horses. The conductor pulls a large lever and cries, all off from the seaside. Which instant the four horses peel off from the merry-go-round. As the horses get to the sand, they sink into it. On the last note of the melody, they all dismount, and the children run to play in the sand.
It's sand! It's real sand! Well, of course it's real sand, says Bert. But Mary Poppins, This isn't the real seaside.
It's real if you think it is.
But can't we stay and play, Mary Poppins? You can have 5 minutes.
We will go for a walk.
Now, in this scene, let them walk along the dunes very gently into the sunset. And the very most that he does is take her hand.
Would you like to hear the song again, or just go on?
No, I'd like to go on now, because...
At the conclusion of the song, the children come running toward Mary and Bert, loaded down with starfish and shrimp.
Let's take them home, one only. Never take more than you need. She's always putting forth these. Then she looks at her watch and says, spit spot and home we go. And then Michael asks her, when does the wind? And here I see you have, why don't we ask Admiral Boone? He's an authority on such matters. Admiral, do you know when the wind will change? Things will come when they will. And then he begins his song.
Have no fear, me hearties, my hand seems true. Keep ho and hold a steady course tonight. I've never lost a battle, I've never lost a crew. Of course, I've never really been in a fight. But I'm primed, ripe, and ready, ready to do or die, or ready to face the briny blast and blow. So heave ho, me hearties, and fight the colors high.
That's right, but you can't sink a wind, and then they all sing together.
And they all sing, Admiral,
I swing on the sea of the enemy and send them down to their doom, down to their doom, 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 doom. It's plain to see why the Admiral chief is proud of the power of Admiral, proud of Admiral, proud of Admiral, boom, boom.
They are skimming along the ocean in their beautiful house. It looks like it doesn't look like a boat. It looks like a house, but they're on the ocean anyhow.
Yes, yes, I see.
And he sings away in his lusty sea chanty voice. They've all changed into seaman's suit, except for Mary Poppins, who is just quietly sipping her tea.
Oh, look! There's a whirlwind. Ho-ho! Whirlwind to leeward. Battle station, clear the rigging before the target death.
Michael Jane and Pinnacle go below to the drawing room.
But only the Admiral will carry it off while Binnacle and the children go below. And Mary Poppins takes it.
With the harpoon?
Yes. She takes it from the side.
And just, by Jove, harpoon well. Very good, very good.
She's done away with the harpoon. She's always saying it's time to go home.
Actually, Mr. Travers, you know, in this particular case, that boom, you know, you just sort of fade out.
That's right. Good.
You don't have to go into a
spot. No. Mary and the children go up the stairs, and Jane says excitedly, Timbuktu. That's a lovely word. I would love to go to Timbuktu. It has such a wonderful sound. And then Mary Poppins starts singing her East is East. Let's have the music.
East is east, a west is west, a compass is a compass, and anywhere you go is best when you're with Mary Poppins.
The children are sitting on the soap, looking at the compass. And Mary Poppins sits down and says, where was it you wanted to go, Jane? Timbuktu? All right, go along, spin the compass.
And all of a sudden, we hear jumbo drums. And the scene changes, and they're on the plush sofa, and they're floating down the Niger River. And the drums are going back. And Michael says, this is a very strange country, Mary Poppins. And then she just comes right and says, strange is perhaps, strange to you, but not to be inhabitants of Timbuktu. There's nothing new in Timbuktu. They all do what they always do. The river flows, the jungle grows, and the elephants in Timbuktu. There's nothing new in Timbuktu. They all do what they always do. The river flows, the jungle grows, and the monkeys in Timbuktu. The river flows, the jungle grows, and the river in Timbuktu. The river flows, the jungle grows, and giraffes
Well, they just chew.
In Timbuktu.
They come to this little riverbank, and all the animals gather around and serenade them.
This melody, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. These animal sounds are used as instruments of an orchestra.
You mean a bassoon.
Right. Mm-hmm. But if we see a gnu, perhaps, doing, you know,
this would be scored for...
Scored for sound.
Animal
sound. No instruments.
It's a completely original concept of presenting a musical number, but it's integral to these experiences on the around the world compass sequence, the excitement that these children are having in the company of Mary, and yet there's nothing complete. They leave one scene because of one reason and another.
What disappoints them in this that makes them go somewhere else?
Well, we come to the rapids. It's a dangerous thing.
Mr. Travers, you see, Don has a sketch there of these falls, and they're just very exciting.
Well, now she continues the song, then you're coming round and you hear the roar of the waterfall in the distance goes faster and faster.
Right.
And you see the sofa about to plunge over the falls. The children must say, we mustn't go over the falls, there's one who's dangerous. All right, where would you like to go now? Where's the compass? Oh, I had it a minute. Here it is under the pillar. Let me spin it now, says Michael.
Yes.
You see?
And of course the climax is coming because they just allowed to go over when he spins it.
Yes. Somewhere dry, he shrieks. Go on then, he spins the compass.